Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Aparajita Bhatt from National Law University, Delhi. The topic for this module is Takeovers and Acquisitions. The learning objectives of this module are that you shall be able to understand the concept of takeovers and acquisitions. You shall also be able to understand and appreciate the difference between takeover, acquisition and mergers. And you shall also be able to understand various legal provisions governing takeovers in India. We must understand what is meant by takeover. Takeover and acquisition is a form of inorganic corporate restructuring where the management of the company changes its hands. A takeover takes place when one company acquires controlling interest over another company. There are many kinds of takeovers which are prevalent in the corporate sector. One is friendly takeover. For example, when Dabur acquired Balsara Group, that's an example of friendly takeover. Another category is hostile takeover. For example, when HP acquired Compaq. And a third new category, which is altogether different, is bailout takeover. Now, let us briefly understand the meaning of all these three kinds of takeovers. In case of a friendly takeover, when it is done with the consent of board of directors or board of management of the target company, so because the element of consent is present, it is a friendly takeover. In case of a hostile takeover, when such a takeover is done without the consent of the board of management of the target company, if the board rejects the offer, then the bidder continues to pursue it. Therefore, it is against the wishes or without the consent of the board of management of the target company, and therefore, it is a hostile takeover. And a third category, which is altogether different from friendly or hostile, is a bailout takeover. In case of a bailout takeover, the financially weak company, which is the target company, is bailed out to a strong company with the interference of a financial institution or a bank. Now, let us understand the difference between a takeover and a merger, because both of them are inorganic or external forms of corporate restructuring exercises. In case of a merger or amalgamation, both the companies become one, they blend into one, they merge into one with each other, whereas in case of a takeover, there continues to be two distinct companies and the assets, liabilities, stocks, they are not shared or merged. We must also understand the difference between takeover and acquisition. Both these terms, takeover and acquisition, they sound to be and are used synonymously, but there is a difference between both these terms. In case of an acquisition, it necessarily involves the purchase of shares of a target company, which can further lead to acquisition of voting power. When such an acquisition of voting power or such an acquisition of shares or the purchase of shares, it is with an intention to take control of the target company, such kind of acquisition becomes a takeover. Therefore, irrespective of whether there is a takeover of a company or not, there is necessarily present an acquisition of shares, and it occurs whenever shares of the target company changes hands. Therefore, in case of a takeover, the element of intention to control the management of the target company is present, whereas in case of a simple acquisition of shares, this element of intention to control the target company is necessarily not present. Now, there are various kinds of companies, as we know. There are private companies and public companies, which can further be divided into listed and unlisted company. So, the takeover procedure or mechanism of listed and unlisted company are different. Takeover of unlisted company are presently governed by the Companies Act under section 395. Under this section, it is both a power as well as a duty of the acquirer company to acquire shares of the target company. Because this is a takeover of the unlisted company, it requires lesser procedural compliance, but which whatever is required is mentioned under the Companies Act. And the dissenting shareholders, they are offered a compensation, a fair compensation, and they also have an option to exit the company, to exit the offer, if they are not interested to be involved in the process of takeover. Whereas takeover of listed companies because they are listed on stock exchanges and they are governed by SEBI, the Securities Exchange Board of India. So, takeover of listed companies is governed by SEBI Takeover Regulations 2011. Now, there is a set of regulations which governs takeovers and acquisitions in India. These regulations include the Indian Companies Act, the SEBI SAST Takeover Regulations 2011, the Securities Contract Regulation Act 1957, and also the Listing Agreement. Now, before we proceed and discuss the legal provisions relating to takeover and acquisition under the Takeover Code 2011, let us try and understand that what was the need to have this takeover code in our country. The need to govern takeovers and acquisitions, it emerged from the need to govern those companies and those corporate houses which made it a fashion to acquire controlling interests in other companies. Takeover turns hostile when it is done without the consent of board of directors of the target company. So, there are all probabilities that such an acquisition would adversely affect the interests of minority shareholders, the other stakeholders of the target company. And as we all know that takeover is a corporate decision, it should be beneficial not only for the acquirer company, but also it should be beneficial for the shareholders at large and not merely for the benefit of the individuals. Now, because of the complexity of the nature of takeover and also to protect the interest of small investors as well as the target company, a need was felt to develop a code to regulate and to govern the entire process of acquisition and takeover, which is based on principle of transparency, which is based on principle of fairness and equal opportunity to all. A greater need was felt and it was realized only after the introduction of the LPG model. As we all know, it's the liberalization, privatization and globalization model, which was introduced in 1991. So, only after the introduction of this LPG model in 1991, it was felt that we need to have a set of regulation, we need to have a code which could govern the cross-border corporate restructuring activities, cross-border takeovers, cross-border amalgamations or acquisitions. Therefore, this LPG model, it opened the gates of Indian economy for foreign investors and it began a trend wherein the companies wanted to restructure themselves by inorganic means such as mergers and amalgamations. The most important reason behind having a proper takeover regulation was to achieve the objective behind the SEBI Act. And the main objective behind the SEBI Act is given under Section 11 of the SEBI Act, that is to protect the interest of the shareholders of the target companies besides achieving the desired target of the acquirer companies. A need was felt to have a code, to have a regulation which could imbibe within itself the principles of corporate democracy, the principle of transparency, fairness and equal opportunity for all. With such broad objectives, SEBI enacted the Takeover Regulation 1994, which was further amended in 1997 and still further amended in the year 2011. And now what we have to govern the takeover or acquisition activities in India is the SEBI SAST Regulations 2011. In the light of the changing market policies and changing needs of the corporate world, there was again a need felt for new regulations to govern mergers and acquisitions. Thus, in 2009, a committee which was constituted under the chairmanship of Achutan, Mr. C. Achutan, popularly known as TRAC, Takeover Regulatory Advisory Committee. This committee was constituted to look into the challenges, to look into the loopholes which were present under the takeover regulations in 1997. The Achutan Committee recommended several changes in the 1997 regulations. The committee recommendations or the committee report was not accepted in whole by SEBI, but it approved major recommendations of it. Thus, takeover regulations were replaced by the new SEBI Substantial Acquisition of Shares and Takeover Regulations 2011. Now, let us also discuss the trend of takeovers and acquisitions in India. The trend of takeovers and acquisitions in India, it witnessed significant regulatory changes in 2011 as we just discussed. And when this new takeover regulation 2011 came into force, it brought with it several unique features which now govern the takeover transactions, the acquisition transactions in our country. And especially it applies to public listed companies. The basic principles which applies to an acquisition and a takeover is that in case of a takeover, compliance of both the takeover code as well as the act is necessary. While in case of only acquisition, especially in case of acquisition of unlisted companies, compliance only of the act is required. Similarly, there are other variants which can be added to it. So when an acquisition becomes a takeover, the provision of SEBI Takeover Code 2011 becomes applicable, as we all know. Similarly, if an acquisition results in a combination, then along with the Takeover Code 2011, the provisions of the Competition Act 2002, which were further amended in 2007, would also apply, and the approval of Competition Commission of India is required in such a case. And if the acquisition results in either inflow or outflow of funds to and from India, then the provisions of FEMA 1999, that is the Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999, would also become applicable along with the Takeover Code 2011. Now, after having discussed the basic, the fundamental concept, the meaning of takeover, acquisition and the differences between them, now let us discuss the various legal provisions. SEBI is a body, is an authority which has given to us a very comprehensive set of regulation which governs all forms of takeover activities in India. And therefore, all kinds of takeover, whether friendly, whether hostile, have to necessarily go through the procedure which is given under the SEBI Takeover Code. This code involves the acquisition of shares in a substantial percentage, which leads to acquisition of control and finally takeover of a target company. It also applies to acquisition by a company. This acquisition can be acquisition of shares, acquisition of voting power and acquisition of control. Acquisition of shares can be either direct acquisition or indirect acquisition. Now, what is a direct acquisition? A direct acquisition is when control of a public listed company is by way of acquisition of shares of the target company directly. Whereas an indirect acquisition, it is done by acquiring shares of a holding company or a parent company of the target company. Therefore, both these forms of acquisition, they are given under SEBI Takeover Code and are governed by the same regulation. SEBI Takeover Code also gives to us a process which is known as an open offer process. The Takeover Code mandates an open offer process for both direct as well as indirect acquisition of shares, voting rights or control if such acquisition triggers the threshold prescribed under the Takeover Code. Now, what is this threshold? We need to understand this. This threshold is given under Regulation 3 of the Takeover Code 2011. Regulation 3 gives to us the concept of substantial acquisition of shares, voting rights and control. Thus, every acquisition of shares is not a takeover, only substantial acquisition of shares is a takeover, and if it is so, whenever it is a case of substantial acquisition of shares, then the acquirer company has to comply with the provision, comply with the norms given under Regulation 3 of the Takeover Code, which requires the acquirer company to follow an open offer process. Regulation 3 of the code requires a public announcement to be made for every acquisition of shares, every acquisition of voting rights and every acquisition of control, which is more than 25% but less than the maximum permissible non-public shareholding in a financial year, which is generally 75%. Thus, there is no requirement of going through an open offer process by making a public announcement if the acquirer acquires shares up to 24.99% within a financial year. But as soon as he triggers this threshold of 25%, he has to make a public announcement and he has to go through this open offer process. This percentage, which is given under the Takeover Code 2011, was quite low under the previous takeover regulation. It was only 15%, but now they have increased it to 25%, which comes in a form of relaxation both to the acquirer companies as well as to the shareholders. The open offer process requirement should be fulfilled only when there is a substantial acquisition of shares or voting rights or control. Having done substantial acquisition of shares or voting rights or control by making a public announcement, if an acquirer has to acquire additional shares which entitles him to exercise more than 5% of voting rights in a financial year, he is again required to make public announcement of an open offer. From this, we get the concept of creeping acquisition. The concept of creeping acquisition allows an acquirer to acquire additional shares every year, I mean every financial year, up to 5%, for which he is not required to follow the open offer process. So, if he acquires 5%, up to 5% in one financial year, for that he is not required to make public announcement, he is not required to follow any open offer process. So, therefore, this is a slow acquisition, this is a creeping acquisition. But this can be done only once he has acquired substantial acquisition of shares. He has done substantial acquisition of shares or control or voting power. Now, under the Takeover Code of 1997, as we just discussed, an acquirer was mandated to make an open offer if he alone or through persons acting in concert with him, they were acquiring 15% or more of voting right in the target company. This threshold of 15% has been increased to 25% under the Takeover Code 2011. Now, what is meant by acquisition of control? Acquisition of control substantially differs from acquisition of shares and voting power. Takeover Code mandates making of a public announcement of an open offer for acquisition of control, which is done either directly or indirectly over a target company. This is irrespective of acquisition or holding of shares or voting rights in a target company. The Code of 2011 under Regulation 5 gives to us the concept of indirect acquisition of shares or control. In case of an indirect acquisition of shares or control, the acquisition of shares, voting rights or control over any other company which would enable the acquirer of shares, voting rights or control to exercise such percentage of voting rights which would otherwise have triggered an open offer process and which would enable him to enable the acquirer to exercise control over of a company, then this becomes a kind of indirect acquisition and not a direct acquisition. Thereby it is meant and thereby it is concluded that even in case of an indirect acquisition, he has to follow the open offer process. The concept of deemed direct acquisition is a little different from indirect acquisition. Few or certain indirect acquisitions, they are regarded as deemed direct acquisition or deemed to be direct acquisition. If such indirect acquisition satisfies few conditions, these conditions are that if the proportionate net asset value of the target company as a percentage of the consolidated net asset value of the entity or business being acquired exceeds 80%, or the proportionate sales turnover of target company as a percentage of the consolidated sales turnover of the entity or business being acquired exceeds 80%, or the proportionate market capitalization of the target company as a percentage of the enterprise value for the entity or business being acquired exceeds 80%. The deemed direct acquisition in all these three cases has to follow the same mandatory open offer process related requirement which are being followed in case of a direct acquisition of shares, a direct acquisition of voting rights or direct acquisition of control. Regulation 6 of the Takeover Code 2011 makes us understand the concept of voluntary offer. It provides an option to make a voluntary offer under the Takeover Code of 2011 to those shareholders who already hold at least 25% or more but less than 75% of the shares or voting rights of that company. The reason is they wish to further consolidate their existing shareholding rights in the company, then this option to exercise voluntary offer is given to such shareholders. Voluntary offer enables such shareholders to acquire further shares representing at least 10% of the total shareholding of the company. But making of such a voluntary offer is not without restriction. So therefore, there are certain restrictions to make a voluntary offer. For example, one is it puts a moratorium period. A person who either individually or together with the persons acting in concert has acquired shares or voting rights or control in the preceding 52 weeks, otherwise then pursuant to an open offer, is not entitled to make a voluntary offer. Similarly, during the offer period of such voluntary offer, acquisition of shares in the target company are prohibited. Another restriction is that the acquirer who makes a voluntary offer is not entitled to acquire any shares of the target company for a period of further 6 months after the completion of that voluntary offer, except by way of another voluntary offer or a competing offer. And another restriction is that the shares proposed to be acquired under the voluntary offer should not be in such number so as to reduce the public shareholding of the target company below the minimum permissible limit, assuming that the offer is accepted in full. Therefore, these restrictions have to be followed in case of a voluntary offer, and this facilitative provision or option is given to those shareholders who want to further consolidate their shareholding only after they have already made a substantial acquisition of shares or voting rights or control in the target company. Similarly, there is another requirement to be followed under the takeover code, that is, what is the offer size. We have to be aware of this particular fact that all these provisions are given under the takeover code to make sure that a takeover or acquisition, even if done in a hostile manner or friendly manner, is not against the interest of the minority shareholders or investors or target company. Therefore, what should be the offer size in a takeover is provided under Regulation 7. Regulation 7 explains that any acquirer who has already made substantial acquisition of shares or voting rights or control can make an offer for at least 26% of the total shares of the target company within a period of 10th working day from the closure of the tendering period. Now, what does that mean? It means Regulation 7 allows to make an offer size of 26%, and the acquirer has already made a substantial acquisition of 25% as allowed by Regulation 3. Therefore, under the new Takeover Code 2011, an acquirer company in one go can acquire 25 plus 26%, that is up to 51% of shareholding or voting power or control in the target company, which gives a very broad scope to the acquirer company to acquire shares in the target company. The voluntary open offer made through public announcement under Regulation 6, it enables the acquirer to acquire at least such number of shares as would entitle him to exercise an additional 10% of the total shares of the target company. But the post-acquisition holding of the acquirer should not exceed the maximum permissible non-public shareholding applicable to such target company. The limitation in terms of offer size is not same in case of a competing offer. If the offer is a competing offer and the acquirer has made a voluntary offer, then he is entitled to increase the number of shares within a period of 15 working days to such number as he deems fit. And after the lapse of these 15 days, the acquirer shall not be able to increase the offer size. Regulation 8 provides us and states as to what should be the offer price and how it should be calculated, which again has been stated or mentioned in the interest of the shareholders of the target company. In case of a direct or indirect acquisition of shares or voting rights or control over the target company, the offer price shall be the highest of the following. It shall be the highest negotiated price per share of the target company for any acquisition under the agreement attaching the obligation to make a public announcement of an open offer, or the volume weighted average price paid or payable for acquisitions, whether by the acquirer or by any person acting in concert with him during the 52 week immediately preceding the date of public announcement, or the highest price paid or payable for any acquisition, whether by way of acquirer or by any person acting in concert with him during 26 weeks immediately preceding the date of the public announcement. the volume weighted average market price of such shares for a period of 60 trading days immediately preceding the date of public announcement as traded on the stock exchange, where the maximum volume of trading in the shares of the target company are recorded during such period, provided such shares are frequently traded. Where the shares are not frequently traded, the price determined by the acquirer and the manager to the open offer, taking into account valuation parameters and such other parameters as are customary for valuation of shares of such company, and the per share value computed under sub-regulation 5 if applicable. So therefore, whichever is the highest price out of these, that shall be the offer price under the Takeover Code 2011. Now, what shall be the mode of payment? This again is mentioned under the Takeover Code under Regulation 9. The mode of payment can be either in cash or by issue, exchange of transfer of listed shares in the equity share capital of the acquirer, or listed secured debt instruments issued by the acquirer, or issue, exchange or transfer of convertible debt securities, and the code also permits a combination of all these modes. Now, the code is not without exemptions. There are few categories which are exempted from the regulations, from the procedure mentioned under the code. These general exemptions are mentioned under Regulation 10. The first is acquisition pursuant to interstate transfer of shares amongst qualifying persons, being immediate relatives, persons named as promoters in the shareholding pattern filed by the target company in terms of listing agreement, or these regulations for not less than 3 years prior to the proposed acquisition. Another exemption is a company or its subsidiary, its holding company, other subsidiaries of such holding companies, persons holding not less than 50% of the equity shares of such company or other companies in which such persons hold not less than 50% of the equity shares, and their subsidiaries subject to control over such qualifying persons being exclusively held by the same persons. The exemption also includes such persons who are acting in concert for not less than 3 years prior to the proposed acquisition and disclosed as such pursuant to filings under the listing agreement. It also applies to shareholders of a target company who have been persons acting in concert for a period of not less than 3 years prior to the proposed acquisition and are disclosed as such pursuant to the filings under the listing agreement, and any company in which the entire equity share capital is owned by such shareholders in the same proportion as their holdings in the target company without any differential entitlement to exercise voting rights in such company. Therefore, all these together form general exemptions under Regulation 10 of the Takeover Code 2011. Now, after having followed all these provisions with respect to making an open offer, making a public announcement, after having understood that how a voluntary offer is made, what is meant by direct and indirect acquisition, what should be the offer size and what should be the offer price, we should also understand that when this process of acquisition should be completed. Therefore, the provisions relating to and the procedure relating to the completion of acquisition is given under Regulation 22. Regulation 22 states that the acquisition process gets complete only after the expiry of the offer period. The Takeover Code mandates the opening of an escrow account into which the amount in cash equal to 100% of the consideration as fixed between the parties has to be deposited. That means that total 100% amount in cash has to be deposited into the escrow account. After the period of 21 working days from the date of detailed public statement, that is DPS, the code allows the parties to act upon the agreement and acquire shares or voting rights or control over the target company. The maximum period for the acquirer to complete the acquisition process is 26 weeks from the expiry of the offer period. This time period of 26 weeks may be extended by Board of Directors in case there is an extraordinary circumstance. And the Board of Directors, before granting such extension, would look into the interest of investors in general. The main issue which arises here is that if once the open offer is made or substantial acquisition offer is made, then whether an acquirer company can withdraw such an open offer. So withdrawal of open offer is mentioned under Regulation 23 of the Code. There are only certain circumstances under which the open offer can be withdrawn. Otherwise, it is not allowed to withdraw this open offer. The circumstances are that if the statutory approvals required for the open offer or for effecting the acquisition, attracting the obligation to make an open offer under these regulations have been finally refused by the authorities, subject to such requirement for approval having been specifically disclosed in the detailed public statement and the letter of offer. Another circumstance can be that the acquirer, being a natural person, has died. Another situation to withdraw an open offer may arise wherein any condition stipulated in the agreement for acquisition attracting the obligation to make the open offer is not met for reasons outside the control of the acquirer, for such reasons which are outside the reasonable control of the acquirer, and such agreement is rescinded subject to such conditions having been specifically disclosed in the detailed public statement and the letter for offer. Or another ground can be such circumstances as in the opinion of the board merit withdrawal. So in these cases, in these circumstances, an open offer once made can be withdrawn also. But if the open offer is withdrawn, then the acquirer within 2 working days is required to make an announcement in the same newspaper in which the public announcement of the open offer was published. The code mandates the information to be given in writing to the board, to all the stock exchanges on which the shares of the target company are listed, and the target company at its registered office. This is only to make sure that there is enough and there is proper communication done to the investors, to the shareholders, to the board of directors of the target company. Now, after having discussed and after knowing all these important provisions relating to takeover procedure, we should also understand as to the what is the role of independent directors under the takeover code. The takeover code of 2011, it makes it mandatory for the board of directors of the target company to constitute a committee of independent directors. Now, these independent directors, they are also entitled to seek external professional advice on the same. So, once this committee of independent directors will be constituted, they have to provide written reasoned recommendation on such open offer which the target company is required to publish. Therefore, today we discussed the concept and the meaning of takeover and acquisition, the difference between these two important terms. They are two important inorganic corporate restructuring activities which companies undertake to acquire shares or stocks or voting power or control over the target company. But because to make sure that this is not done in an arbitrary manner, the code provides a set mechanism to be followed, to be complied. It provides various unique features which were not present under the previous code, such as it provides exit option for public shareholders to exit. It also provides and states it allows the raising of threshold for making an open offer from 15% to 25%, whether it is a direct open offer or indirect open offer. And also it gives a revised list of exemptions, and many more such unique features are there which were not present earlier. Therefore, it would be right and correct to conclude that Takeover Code 2011 focuses on the principles of corporate democracy, transparency, fairness, and it also ensures the interest of investors, which is the primary objective of the SEBI Act. Thank you.